Gan Shalom Akyam, Avonik of all praise, honor and glory to Yahweh, Bahasham, Yahweh Shai, Bahasham Raka Kadesh. Double honors to the other apostles of Great Millstone who teach and rule well, and Shalom to the sense Akyam spreads truth and sincerity. Shalom. In this video, I want to go into James, the third chapter, which is going into, the tongue, which that goes into the words that we speak. So this is James chapter 3 and verse 1, and it says, "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation." And if you go to the word masters, it is didaskalos, which goes into teacher. It says in the New Testament, when he teaches concerning the things of the Most High and the duties of men. So, that goes into, being a teacher for Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai. The second word that I want to go into is the word condemnation, which is that word krima, which says a decree, judgment, a condemnation of wrong, decision, with a severe melt, which one passes on the faults of others. So that goes into judgment. So when we read James, the third chapter again, it says, James chapter 3 and verse 1, "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation." So what this verse is going into is that, don't desire to be a teacher if you're not aware of the consequences that come with being a teacher for Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai. Because being a teacher for Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai, being a servant of the prophet, comes with great responsibilities. You see, first and foremost, you're gonna have to be an example, but also you're gonna have to make sure that what you teach is correct and the truth. And if you don't do that, and if you don't take the responsibilities that come with the teacher, bring out the word, you're gonna be judged for that accordingly. You see, for example, if we go to Ezekiel the third chapter. We go to the 17th verse, it says, "Son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore hear the word in my mouth and give them warning from me." So being a teacher also means you're a watchman. And a watchman is supposed to look out and give warning when danger is coming or is approaching. You see, and that's what Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai has been doing with the service of the prophets. You see. Page 29, select Jeremiah. It says, this is Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 19, "Because they have not hearkened to my words, said the Lord Yahweh, which I sent unto them by my servants the prophets, rising up early and sending them, but ye would not hear, said the Lord Yahweh." So the way that the Most High is warning the people upon his earth, and be more specific, the Israelites are so good, Negroes, Latinos, and Native Americans, but also those that are scattered among the heathen nations, that might look like the heathen nations, but his lineage just go back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob according to their father's seed line. We're being set up and being commanded to speak unto our people the words of prophecy. You see, we're also being made prophets of the nations, declaring unto the heathen nations what their future is going to be, you see. But us as watchmen being set up, we're trying to warn our people, you see, from the things that are coming upon the earth through the spirit of power of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai, sword, famine, death, and destruction, you see. And Most High is doing that, for over 35 years now. Abba Pastor Har has been speaking his words for more than 30 years. You see, in around 1970, the Most High raised up Abba Bivens, and through the Spirit he was able to break down Deuteronomy chapter 28, which talks about the curses that came upon our people. You see, so the truth, has been out there for a while now. So the Most High has sent them, before the destruction is coming. You see, that's what the task is of a watchman. He looks out for the danger, and it's giving the people warning. See, so back to Ezekiel, chapter 3, verse 18. When I say unto the wicked, thou shalt surely die, and that givest him not warning, nor speakest to warn the wicked from his wicked way to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thine hand. So part of being a prophet and speaking the word for Yahushua Yahushua is also correcting our people, telling them that they should abstain from their wicked ways and turn back to Yahweh Shem Yahushai. You see, and us knowing this truth, you know, and not bringing it out, you see, that man is gonna die because we didn't tell him, you know, what was coming and what he should have been doing. So his blood's gonna be upon the hand of those that didn't speak the words for Yahweh Shem Yahushai, but knew the will of the Most High. You see, knew what was going on and knew what was coming upon his earth. You see, that's what also is part of the responsibilities that comes with being a teacher for Yahweh Shem Yahushai. You see, verse 19, yet if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he should die in his iniquity, but thou hast delivered thy soul. So if we know this truth, you know, we know the responsibilities that come with it, you know, and we're doing those things that are required of us, and we're warning the wicked from among our people, to turn away from the wickedness and turn back to Yahweh Shem Yahushai, but he's not listening to us. He's not hearkening to what we're saying. You know, he's deciding to remain, you know, a wicked person. He's gonna die because he didn't want to listen. But we have clenched our hand, you know, concerning him. You see, and that's one of the responsibilities that come, you know, with being a teacher. See, and if you don't do those things that come with it, you see, you're going to be judged for that. You know, you're going to be held accountable. You see, this is James chapter 3 and verse 2. For many things we offend all. If any man offend not a word, the same as a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. So, you know, being in the flesh, you know, we're gonna make many mistakes. But if we're able to not offend people by our speech, that same person is seen as a perfect man. And if you're a person that is able to walk in such a manner, you're also able to control your whole body concerning putting things on a subjection. You see, because it says in James chapter 3 and verse 3, it says, behold, we put bits in the mouth, in the horse's mouth, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. So with the bits that goes into the horse's mouth, let me look it up. If that is the equipment being put around the horse's head to steer him in a certain direction, you know, which is symbolic for the way that we can use the words that we speak and our mouth to, you know, steer things in a certain direction, you know, whether it's in a good way or whether it's in a bad way. See, so if you're able to breathe the mouth, you're able to, you know, get better, get things concerning your body also under control. You see, James chapter 3 and verse 4, behold, also the ships, which though they be so great, and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, which is therefore the governor listed. So you have this huge ship, but only a small part of that ship, you know, is steering the direction, you know, where the ship is going. You see, whether the captain of the ship is making the ship go. Only a small you see, so this is able to steer that whole ship, you see, whether to the left or whether to the right, you see. James chapter 3 and verse 5, even so the tongue is a little member and boasts of great things. Behold how great a matter a little fire kindled. So the tongue, you know, compared to the whole body, is only a small member of the whole body. But the tongue is able to cause a lot of troubles. See verse 6. And the tongue is a fire, a wood of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body. It set it on fire, the course of nature, and it is set on fire. You see, so by the words you speak, you know, you're able to cause fights, you're able to offend a person just by the words that you're saying. But with the same words, you're able to comfort a brother, you know, you're able to have a good conversation with someone. You see, so you can either go to the left or to the right. You know? It says verse 7, for every kind of beasts, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind. So, every animal upon this earth is able to be tamed. You see that in the circuses, you know, certain animals, you know, can be tamed to do certain things. Verse 8, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. You see, so it's very hard for us to try to get it under control. You see? Verse 10, out of the same mouth proceed the blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be so. You see, so out of the same mouth, the same tongue, you know, you're able to speak curses. You're able to speak blessings, which those are two opposites of each other. You know, which one is a good thing, the other is, you know, considered to be, you know, not so good. You see, putting curses on people, putting blessings on people, you see. And one thing that I want to go into as well is an example in the scriptures of someone who cursed King David and what it eventually led towards. You see, because by the way that he used his mouth, the words that proceeded out of his mouth, you see, he eventually caused himself, you know, to, you know, basically be put to death. You see, this is something that has been written in the law, that we're not supposed to curse the ruler of our people. This is Exodus chapter 22, verse 28. Thou shalt not revile the gods, nor curse the ruler of that people. You know, this is something that happened, you know, unto King David, who was the ruler of our people, you know, back in the days. This is 2 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 5. And when King David came to Bahurim, behold, thence came out a man of the family of the house of Saul, whose name was Shimei, the son of Gera. He came forth and cursed still as he came. So this man, Shimei, he was, you know, on the side of King Saul, ex-King Saul. You see, and he was cursing King David, you know, as he passed by. Verse 6, and he cast stones at David and at all the servants of the king of King David, and all the people and all the mighty men who were on his right hand and on his left. So King David was surrounded by his mighty men, but this man, he was cursing King David and was throwing, you know, stones at him. You see, so this man, you know, the most really, you know, put spirit upon him to do that. Because who would do such a thing, you know, if someone is surrounded by, you know, very strong and mighty men that are able to, you know, get a lot of people at, you know, during a period of time. Correct. Because these are examples that I'm going to pull concerning the mighty men of King David and what they were able to do. This is 2 Samuel chapter 23 and verse 8. These be the names of the mighty men whom David had, the Tagmanite that sat in the seat, chief among the captains, the same as Adino the Asnite. He lifted up his spear against 800 whom he slew at one time. You see, so during one fight that he had, during one instance, you know, he was able to beat 800 men by himself. And after him was Eliezer the son of Dodo, the Ahohite, one of the three mighty men with David, when they defied the Philistines that were gathered together to battle, and the men of Israel were gone away. He arose and smote the Philistines until his hand was weary, and his hand clave unto the sword. And the Lord Jehovah wrought a great victory that day, and the people returned after him only to spoil. So this battle was so fierce, you know, that he held on to his sword so tight that eventually, you know, he couldn't let go. His hand was, you know, stuck like this. Verse 11. And after him was Shammah, the son of Agi, the Hararite, and the Philistines were gathered together into a troop. There was a piece of ground dull of lentils, and the people fled from the Philistines. But he stood in the midst of the ground and defended it and slew the Philistines, and the Lord Yahweh brought a great victory. So, you know, this man, you know, Shammah, he also was able to fight against a lot of Philistines defending, you know, a piece of land on which lentils were being grown. Reading on, and three of the 30 chief went down and came to David in the harvest time unto the cave of Adullam, and the troop of the Philistines pitched in the valley of Rephaim. And David was then in an hold, and the garrison of the Philistines was then in Bethlehem. And David longed and said, Oh, that one would give me drink of the water of the well of Bethlehem, which is by the gate. And the three mighty men break through the host of the Philistines and drew water out of the well of Bethlehem that was by the gate and took it and brought it to David. Nevertheless, he would not drink thereof, but poured it out unto the Lord Yahweh. And he said, Be far from me, O Lord Yahweh, that I should do this. Is not this the blood of the men that went in jeopardy of their lives? Therefore he would not drink it. These things did these three mighty men. And if you read on, you know, it goes a little bit more into it concerning what, you know, mighty men of King David were able to do. You see, but King David, he was surrounded by those mighty men when Shimei, you know, the son of Gera, was cursing King David and throwing rocks at him. So this man must have been out of his mind, you know. And 2 Samuel 16, verse 7, And thus said Shimei when he cursed, come out, thou bloody man, and thou man of Belial. So he was calling King David, you know, someone that was, you know, worshipping men of Satan, basically. Verse 8, The Lord Yahweh hath returned upon thee all the blood of the house of Saul, in whose stead thou hast reigned. And the Lord Yahweh hath delivered the kingdom into the hand of Absalom thy son. And behold, thou art taken in thy mischief, because thou art a bloody man. Then said Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, unto the king, Why should this dead dog curse my lord the king? Let me go over, I pray thee, and take off his head. So Abishai, he was like, you know, should I kill this man, you know, for what he's doing unto King David? You know, hey, just give the sign, man, and I'm going to, you know, take him down. Verse 10, And the king said, What have I to do with you, ye sons of Zeruiah? So let him curse, because the Lord Yahweh had said unto him, Curse David. Who shall then say, Wherefore hast thou done so? Verse 11, And David said to Abishai and to all his servants, Behold, my son, which came forth out of my bowels, seeketh my life. How much more now may this Benjamin do it? Let him alone, and let him curse, for the Lord Yahweh hath bidden him. It may be that the Lord Yahweh will look on my affliction, and that the Lord Yahweh will requite me good for this cursing this day. And as David and his men went by the way, Shimei went along on the hillside over against him, and cursed as he went, and threw stones at him, and cast dust. And the king and all the people that were with him came weary and refreshed themselves there. So in this little instance, you know, as King David was being cursed, you know, the words that proceeded out of the mouth of Shimei, you know, were very negative. You know, they eventually came to great fire, as it says in James, you know, chapter 3 and verse 5. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasted great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindled. So, one of the smallest parts of her body, the tongue, you know, the words that we're able to speak with our mouth, they're able to cause a lot of problems, which that's eventually what happened, you know, with Shimei, the son of Gera. Because if we go to 1 Kings, the second chapter, you know, and as King David was about to die, he spoke to his son, King Solomon, of what he ought to do, you know, when he would pass away. This is 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 1. Now the days of David drew nigh that he should die, and he charged Solomon his son, saying, I go the way of all the earth, be thou strong therefore, and show thyself a man, and keep the charge of the Lord Yahweh thy power, to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes and his commandments and his judgments and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, that thou mayest prosper in all that thou doest and whithersoever thou turnest thyself. that the Lord Yahweh may continue his word which he spake concerning me, saying, If thy children take heed to their way, to walk before me in truth with all their heart and with all their soul, there shall not fail thee, said he, a man on the throne of Israel. So the first thing that he charged King Solomon with was to stick with Yahweh, Bashem Yahusha, and to walk in all his ways. One of the other things that he charged King Solomon with was one of the things, you know, concerning Shimei, the son of Gera. This is 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 8. And behold, thou hast with thee Shimei, the son of Gera, a Benjamite of Bahurim, which cursed me with a grievous curse in the day when I went to Mahanaim. But he came down to meet me at Jordan, and I swear to him by the Lord Yahweh, saying, I will not put thee to death with the sword. Now therefore hold him not guiltless, for thou art a wise man, and knowest what thou oughtest to do unto him, but his hoar head bring down to the grave with blood. So King David, you know, said unto Shimei himself, I'm not gonna touch you, I'm not gonna hurt you. Eventually, you know, in the book of Kings, as you know, King David was about to pass away, you know, he told King Solomon to basically take revenge for him, you know. So the words that came out of Shimei's mouth that he spoke to King David, you know, recompensed back in his bosom, you know, in a negative way. Why? Because, you know, he kindled a great fire with the words that came out of his mouth. James chapter 3, verse 6, and the tongue is a fire, a wood of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members that it defileth the whole body, and set it on fire the course of nature, and it set on fire of hell. So I want to go into the account of Shimei when he was executed. So this is 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 36. And the king sent the call for Shimei and said unto him, Build thee a house in Jerusalem, and dwell there, and go not forth thence any whither. So King Solomon commanded Shimei to basically settle down in Jerusalem, and you know, not to leave the place. Verse 37, For it shall be that on the day that thou goest out and passest over the brook Kidron, that thou shalt know for certain that thou shalt surely die, that blood shall be upon thine own head. So if he would do that, you know, he would be put to death. Verse 38, And Shimei said unto the king, Your saying is good, as my lord the king hath said, so would our servant do. And Shimei dwelt in Jerusalem many days. So Shimei eventually he agreed with the saying of King Solomon, and did so. But if you read on, we're going to find out something. Verse 39, And it came to pass at the end of 3 years, that two of the servants of Shimei ran away into Achish, the son of Machad, king of Gath. And they told Shimei, saying, Behold, thy servants be in Gath. And Shimei arose and saddled his ass and went to Gath to Achish to seek his servants. And Shimei went and brought his servants from Gath. And it was told Solomon that Shimei had gone from Jerusalem to Gath and was come again. So it came to pass, you know, after a while that the servants, you know, of Shimei, they ran away. Eventually, Shimei, you know, he went after them. Catch them, bring them back to Jerusalem. You know, the same was being brought back to King Solomon that this thing happened. They were going to find out what happened with Shimei. Verse 42, And the king sent a call for Shimei and said unto him, Did not make thee to swear by the Lord Yahweh, and protested unto thee, saying, Know for certain, on the day that thou goest out and walkest abroad any whither, that thou should surely die. And thou said unto me, The word that I have heard is good. So King Solomon is talking with him, like, you know, didn't I tell you that if you would leave, you were going to die? And you agreed with the things that I said, but, you know, you agree with it. Verse 43, Why then hast thou not kept the oath of the Lord Yahweh and the commandment that I have charged thee with? The king said moreover to Shimei, Thou knowest all the wickedness which thine heart is privy to, that thou didst to David my father. Therefore the Lord Yahweh shall return thy wickedness upon thine own head. So King Solomon is asking, Then why didn't you keep your words? You know, concerning the oath that you made. You know. And he also said, You know the wickedness that you have done towards my father, you know, and this is going to be recompensed unto you. You see, verse 45, and the king and King Solomon shall be blessed, and the throne of David shall be established before the Lord Yahweh forever. So the king commanded Benaiah the son of Jehoiada, which went out and fell upon him, that he died, and the kingdom was established in the hand of Solomon. You see, so that's something that happened with Shimei due to the words that he spake, which, you know, that was the little member, you know, that tongue that in the great fire. You see, so, you know, this is something that we should be mindful of. You know, this lesson is also a lesson for myself, of course. You know, lately I've been meditating upon this more and more, because I've started to really, how do you say that, like meditate upon, you know, saying things too fast, or, you know, speaking everything that comes into my mind, which that's not always a good thing to do. You see, sometimes it's also good to, you know, with patience give answer. As it also says in the Surah 5 and 11, be swift to hear and let the life be sincere, with patience give answer. So, you know, incline your ear unto, you know, things that are being spoken unto you, you know, and you know, with patience give answer is like, you don't have to immediately respond to someone when he's saying something, when he's asking something. Sometimes you can also say like, hey, fuck, or hey, you know, sir, you know, ma'am, or whoever you're talking to, or whoever is, you know, having a conversation with you. Like, you know, I'm gonna come back on what I'm gonna come back on that, you know. And sometimes it's also very good to, you know, let certain thoughts just go away. You know, don't pay attention to it, you know. So with that, you know, you're able to more and more get control over the, you know, the tongue, which that, you know, is a fire, you know, that can be lit by it. It's like it, which the tongue is able to lit a fire. See, so you're at Zaza. You know, this lesson was edifying. So with that, I want to give all praise, honor, and glory to Yahweh, Bahasham, Yahweh Shai, Bahasham HaKadosh. Double honors to the Alba Apostles of Great Millstone, who teach and rule well. Inshallah, one to the sincere Akiyam, spread his truth and sincerity.